Hi, this is Angela Valente-Romeo. This is Colliding Worlds. Today we're going to take you into the home and studio of Judith Hendler. While Judith may describe herself as a designer, she's much more than that. She's truly an artist, a ceramicist, a mosaic artist. She's a painter. She draws. She makes wonderful jewelry. There's not too much that she doesn't do, and she's an incredibly nice woman. So come along with us, and we're going to take Colliding Worlds into the world of Judith Hendler.
Welcome to Colliding Worlds. I'm your host, Angela Valente-Romeo. Come with us as we take you on another journey.
Thank you so much for being with us, Judith. We're in your studio. It's an amazing spot, but I want to hear about how you started on this journey. What got you from poof, poof, poof?
Well, it's a long story. Actually, I started with the jewelry. It was more or less by accident. The jewelry started out because Dave Swedlow, who's my husband's closest friend, was in the continuous form acrylic business, and he made nose cones for planes. Because of the way it was made and because it was bulletproof, it generated an enormous amount of scrap. The problem with the scrap was that, like most plastics, you can't remelt it. All you could do was burn it, and it created such an intense fire that the incinerator that they built for it collapsed in on itself. And so it was after that, Dave called Herb and he said, I have all this scrap here. I'm going to send you some, see what you can do with it. Herb had a real sixth sense about what would appeal to the public and what he could do with it.
Your husband had a very successful furniture line and company, and Ritts was...
Right, Ritts Rattan was what he started, and that was, he started that. Actually, he had retired from that business when he was doing the acrylic. So he started experimenting with acrylic, and he's very intense. He would research on it, he would read, and he'd experiment. And it wasn't like, you know, a 9-to-5 thing. If he got into something, just go the other way, because until he figured it out, he would stick with it. So he finally did discover how to reclaim the acrylic in a way that it was very much like wood. And because he still had all of this equipment in his factory, he was able to mill it like he did the rattan or the wood or whatever he was using at that time. And one of the interesting things was that he found, because it's a thermoplastic, it will always try to go back to its original shape. Yeah, so this stuff was stretched and it would try to go back. And as it did try to go back, of course, it would shrink and it would flatten out. So what he would do, he'd get all these pieces from Dave and he would cut them up into, I believe it was a 3-foot width at the time. And the reason for that was that he got a turkey oven because it was the only thing he could find that had continuous heat, that kept revolving, had even heat, and that was large enough to, you know, take some of these huge pieces. Because, you know, think of a nose cone on an airplane, no matter how you would cut it. So he put these in the turkey oven and they'd flatten out, and then he had this nice selection of flat material that he could start from. And he made just amazing things from it. They were just gorgeous. Well, of course, I came along and saw this beautiful material, because the fascination about the acrylic, this really beautiful acrylic, is it's very much like crystal. There's no green cast. It's just a beautiful, pure white light. And when the light comes through the piece, it just breaks it up into a million prisms, and it is gorgeous. So at the time, I was doing paper casting, which also found its way to Herb's oven, because he'd see me out there, I'd be out in the deck, and you know, it'd take forever to dry. And he said, well, why don't you let me put that in the oven? And I said, oh, well, you know, that's a great idea. He said, but it can only be 3 feet wide, that's it. And then the last thing that I did was a show at the Brand Library in Glendale. And I made a necklace to wear, and of course the necklace got so much attention, and the paper, you know, sat on the wall. I think I sold one or two pieces because it didn't match people's couches. It was so big, it was this and that. So it turned me in another direction. And I thought, okay, I'm going to make the jewelry, and I'll make one-of-a-kind pieces, and I'll take it to art fairs, and I'll sell them there. And while I was working on this with the scraps that I had gleaned from her, he'd come in and he'd say, you need more earrings. And I think, well, why do I need more earrings? And, you know, I said, why? I've got three earrings. So that, and he said, no, you need more earrings. And he kept bugging me to have more and more. I said, well, I'm only making one of each. And anyway, finally, he did come in one day and he said, that's it, you got it. He said, now you have a line and you're ready to go. And I said, what are you talking about? He said, well, you're going to pack this up. And he presented me with this beautiful Bordeaux briefcase. It was just lovely. It was all lined with the same kind of velvety material inside of the Bordeaux. So the clear acrylic really popped off of it. And he said, yeah, he said, call up the buyers and make an appointment. Well, my entire career had been behind the scenes. I was either an art director or a designer, or I went to the factories or the print facilities to check on things. I was never out with the public. Retail was not part of my persona. It was very much part of his. So whatever he told me, I just assumed was gospel. And he said, well, just call New York, talk to the buyers.
Tell them you're coming. They're going to see you right away.
Yeah, he said, tell them you're a designer from Malibu, and, you know, they'll be happy to see you. Well, and those were the days when actually you could still talk to someone, and somebody would eventually answer the phone. So I call up, and, of course, I got all kinds of appointments, and I packed up, and I went to New York, and I think I saw all the major stores, and I was thrown out by all the major stores. So having a very stubborn streak in me, and having, oh, this was just a couple years after I left Neutrogena, maybe about three or so at the most, because I had no idea this would be the direction that I would take. It wasn't, I mean, if you would have laid out 10,000 things on the table for me to choose from, I never would have expected to end up in retail. So I didn't want to be a failure. Nope. You know, it was terrible. Nobody likes this. Nobody wants it. But I had been wearing it around town, and I'd go through Beverly Hills to see what was in the windows, what they were showing. And I thought, well, people really respond to this. Matter of fact, one point I was literally chased into Saks Fifth Avenue in Beverly Hills. These women were walking behind me, and I thought that I was going to be mugged or accosted.
Mugged in Beverly Hills.
You can actually.
With a Louis bag.
My friend's mother, I think, actually was. And I ran into Saks, and the women followed me in there. And I turned around, I looked at them. She said, we were trying to stop you. Where did you get your jewelry? We want to buy it too. And I thought, well, good, I'm not being mugged, and there is a customer for the jewelry.
The jewelry is really interesting, and it's like, it did. It started its life as a nose cone.
As a nose cone of a plane
of
or
a plane.
A plane window.
It had a very, very manly, militaristic beginning. And you transformed it into something really gorgeous.
But that wasn't what started it. When I was in New York, and I was so, you know, disappointed. I mean, I was hurt, and I was upset. And, these buyers don't just say, no, thank you. We appreciate you coming in. They look at you. What are you thinking? That's the worst stuff I've ever seen in my life. You think people are going to wear that? I mean, this was the kind of thing that you got, you know, and even worse than that. So I called my friend, Lois, who was in charge of PR at Neutrogena there, and I told her the situation. I said, Lois, I can't come home a failure. Are you kidding? Everybody's thrown me out. You know me, how stubborn I am. She said, oh, Judith, you're going about this all wrong. She said, what you need to do is go to the magazines. I said, well, why am I going to the magazines? They're not going to buy anything. She said, no, you don't understand. What you do is go to the magazines. They want the most outrageous things that they can find to put on their models, to be on the cover, so that they can sell the magazine. They don't care if your jewelry sells. They want their magazine to sell.
Yep.
So I said, oh, really? She said, yeah, start with the magazine. So I was going in alphabetical order. So the first magazine, of course, was Harper's Bazaar. So I called, and of course they were willing to see me, and I go up and I have my little Bordeaux briefcase again, and I go up to Harper's Bazaar, and there's a young woman there with all the latest fashion stuff on, and she's chewing gum and doing and talking on the phone and whatever.
A New Yorker.
A New Yorker, yeah. And she says, you know, yeah, what do you want? And I told her who I was, and I said, I have an appointment. She looks at me. She says, yeah, we'll open it up. So I open up my briefcase, and I'm putting things out. And I look up, and she is gone. I thought, wow, wait till I get a hold of Lois on the phone. You know, there are no cell phones at this point. This, we're talking about the early 80s. Okay, no cell phones, no personal computers, nothing. You had to get to a landline phone. You had to hope the person was there. You had to account for the time difference. So, and this is Scratch, who's a supervisor.
He's checking to make sure we're on time. Come on.
Okay, and I'm packing up, and all these thoughts are going through my head, and I'm so upset, and I'm trying to figure out what to do next. And all of a sudden, I hear, as I'm starting to close, what are you doing? Where are you going? And I look up, and the entire editorial staff from Harper's Bazaar is there, and they start opening my little attaché case, and each one's grabbing, said, no, I saw this first. I have something that I have to shoot tomorrow. I have a deadline. And they literally started fighting over the jewelry. And there I was in Harper's Bazaar. And Lois was so right. Once I had that, then I called the store, and the first a large department store to carry me was Mama Teller. I could say, I'm going to be in the Harper's Bazaar next month, and they always had a where to buy, because remember, yep, no internet again, and they had to have a store, someplace where the customer, when they called up, said, oh, yes, you can get it at. So then I could go to the store and say, would you like your name in Harper's Bazaar Vogue L?
For free?
Yeah, and they couldn't get me in the store fast enough.
Hello, I'm Nina Puccillo. Would you like to learn how to cook gorgeous gourmet meals with innovative recipes that are gluten-free, low glycemic, heart healthy, delicious, and nutrient dense? Then check out my cookbook on ninacucina.com.
In the last 14 months, I've dropped 25 pounds. It's with these wonderful recipes out of the Nina Cucina cookbook.
It will give you everything that you need to get healthy today.
So you were kind of breaking ground, and you were also walking a fine line between art jewelry and costume. And, you know, that's, it will be perceived, because it wasn't a precious metal, the tendency would have been to go, and not see the value in it. But you stuck it through. But it really was Nolan Miller giving you that absolute break that propelled this to something.
That was just amazing, and that was in the very beginning. As I said, my original idea was to make a one-of-a-kind piece, and then I had, well, this also was because of Neutrogena, because I was always packaging things and had to think how things were presented to the public. So I had a whole idea in my head, and I wanted to sell The jewelry with this, and actually I have some still, if you'd care to see it. I have some of the original bags which I kept. They were this gorgeous peacock blue, and they were printed with silver, and they were really lovely. So I was looking for the proper color, and the only place I could find, you know, a large selection was in the fabric store, and it happened to be the fabric store that Nolan Miller frequented to purchase fabric from to make clothes for Dynasty, most specifically Joan Collins. And while I was in there with my piece, you know, holding it up against different fabrics to see which color would resonate best with the piece, he saw me. So he gives me his card, and I say thank you very much, and I go about my business. And when I go out to pay for things, the woman behind the counter looks at me. She said, "Do you know who that was?" And I said, "Yeah, I'm writing out my check, you know." Some man, he said his name was Nolan Miller. She said, "Yes, that was Nolan Miller, and he designs for Dynasty." And I said, "Yeah, I heard him." And she said, "Well, you know, that's Joan Collins who he designs for." Now that, for some reason, I knew that name. And I thought, oh my God, he wasn't just a... And I go running after him, and of course he was gone. But he had given me his card, and I did call him. And consequently, I not only went to his design studio, which was very close to where I was living at the time, but I also met Joan Collins, who was extraordinarily gracious and came in and saw the things, because there was no room. All of his tables were filled with clothes, and we didn't know where to put the jewelry. He had called her to come see it. So it ended up on the floor, which was very interesting. And she walks in, and she's not a large woman, and she's very pretty. And she looks at it, and she says, "Oh, Nolan, can we get some of these for Alexis?" Who was her character in Dynasty. And that was the beginning. And she consequently also wrote me just a lovely letter. She's a very, very gracious woman, and he was an extraordinarily gracious man. I worked with him whenever he would have, and anything that Aaron Spelling did, he costumed. So there were a lot of things, and he would call me and he'd say, "Judith, I need jewelry for, or I'm doing a show in such and such for, I'm doing, you know, my new collection." He never once asked ever if he could just have it or borrow it, as most photographers or a lot of other, you know, people did. He always made sure he purchased it from me.
One of the other things that's very interesting is the acrylic is a clear color, and you started to add color to the plastic. How did you do all that?
Well, it was actually fulfilling requests, because all I had in the beginning was the clear, and then the stores started saying, "Oh, you know, Judith, this is summer jewelry," which it really wasn't. And I've been around a long enough time, so I, you know, proved out that I was correct. But anyway, they wanted color, and I had to do something. The problem with the Swedlow material, which this is a piece of Swedlow, and this is that the material was so hard, and it was also coated with a very fine layer of glass, so you couldn't do anything to color it. And it was a lot of experimenting, first of all, finding out a dye that would go on acrylic, that it would take, figuring out how to use the Swedlow material, which we had to end up actually grinding off the entire surface, and then only certain things would take. There was a couple of pieces. This is one that Dave made me. Obviously, aircraft isn't in blue. He made me a sheet of blue, a sheet of seafoam green, a sheet of pink, and a sheet of a smoky mauve color. And that was it. But I couldn't expect him to keep making this for me, because his business was to make things for aircraft. Anyway, so it sent me on a hunt, and we had to find what you could use to dye the plastic. Finally found what was called a hot dip dye, and it would still, the Swedlow acrylic was still so hard that just certain shapes and certain things would take the color. So I had to go to just a standard acrylic after that, like what people think of as lucite, and that would take the color. But again, it was a process where you would polish it, and then you would dye it. And these were all hand dyed. I was the only person doing it at this time. There was a cold dip dye, but that just would streak and it wouldn't look very good. So we went to the hot dip, and it was a whole project. These pieces that you're looking at were done in the 80s. So the color has held up.
The pieces are wonderful. Not only do you have the being a part of the Autry show, there'll be a book about your work.
Yes.
That'll be out by the end of the year, I believe.
Well, we're hoping for a little bit sooner than that, but we'll see.
It's an amazing journey, and to think it started with scraps. I have to say, what I like about it is that whole recycle, upcycle thing. What I like about it is the classicness of it. I like the fact that it's beautiful to wear. It's like wearing a piece of art, and it's fun to be the billboard for it. I've always enjoyed wearing the pieces, and it always does attract people. People always want to know what it is and where it is, and then the next question they always ask, is it heavy?
Yes.
And
yes,
it's like, always. No, watch, I can do all kinds of things. And they're not heavy, and they are beautiful, and they're artistry, and you deserve to be with every one of those women you believe is an artist, because you are one as well. I want to thank you for showing us
how this all
began and where you're going with it.
Well, thank you very much. I appreciate all your words, and
they're beautiful.
Glad that I was able to help you.
I'm so looking forward to seeing more, and there's more coming.
Thank you.
These are the jewelry stylings of Angela Valente Romeo. Upcycled adornment with purpose. Meaningful. Provocative. Art. Each piece individually crafted, combining past, present and future to tell its own story. Visit us at www.theonlyonejewels.com.
Hi, my name is Monica Cuyto. I am born in Lima, Peru. My history is when I am a little girl, I remember 7 years old, my first contact with the art was the competition in my elementary school. I'm making in my art acrylics, for me preferring my work in goods, no? I am by the good, I am cut the good, making different texture. No, for insert different metal, but I am working different series. No, I have the Siri Lido. She's very controversial. The Siri Lido is in honor the woman Lido. The woman Lido, she's dancing in Paris. I don't know what happened. A lot of obsession with Paris, Cancan. I think in my past life, I am living there. My father and my mother born in Cusco. Cusco is in the mountain. No, a lot of energy there, no? I have this energy in my inside, no? I am evoking in my painting the golden color for this reason. A lot of influence in Spanish, the school is Spanish, no? I have my masterpiece. This is my masterpiece. She's traveling. She stayed in different countries, in museum in Mexico. Next November, she will go to Peru for big art show with the master Juan Cuyutupa. She's master painter. She's master in Bellas Artes School. No, it's so honor for me. Right now, I have our collective show in San Diego. I have a big piece. It's 8 foot for 8 foot, no? The series, landscaping. I am invoking in this this is the size, different landscaping, Las Vegas and all Las Vegas, Paris, French Cancan, and Mediterranean, not the colors, the Mediterranean colors. Yeah, it's a big series. Right now, this exhibition is in 57 degrees in San Diego, no? Together with other artists, the Palm Springs, Las Vegas, Los Angeles. It's a bigger show. I am considering my art very different. Don't like make with the brush. I'm making with the spatula, right? Fluent to different colors. When I am capturing San Francisco, different moments, right? And for example, I have a golden color here. All my panties have golden color, but for my influence is the golden colors, yeah, the Spanish influence. But in other piece, and wore happy colors for me. This is the copy for Tahiti, the journal, the Gauguin, when Gauguin stayed in Tahiti. He painting an indigenous, no? Very, some people think it's pornographic, but for me, not. It's a human, right? This is a copy for Tahiti. No, it's very erotic for me, no?
It's very strong.
Yeah, very strong, very erotic. It's not offensive, but some people, it's offensive for me, it's pornographic, but the art is art. It's art. Paul Gauguin right now is in the best museum for the whole world. I have a lot of imagination all the time. I have a lot of crazy idea all the time, no? No painting every day, no? I make my best painting when I am, my feeling is so sad. I don't know. No, when my feeling is so sad, fluent different emotions, different colors, no? After day, oh my God, I'm making this. What happened to me, Monica, no? I don't know. And this painting is my culture. My true culture, my true color, the golden colors, this is a monumental in Cusco, like other monumental in other world, like Egyptian monumental. Right now, the energy for the Tibet is translations here. Do you understand me? Mm-hmm. No?
Yeah.
I'm making my painting for different reasons, no? I'm making my painting for exposure, my feeling, when I'm making different series, controversial, is for me, only for me, no? For explain this creation in my mind, right? I don't know. Some people like my painting, other people no. For me, it's okay, no problem, no? It's my painting. My life is art. My life is passion for the art, no? It's my therapy too, no? I have a lot of depression when I'm moving this country, no? I don't understand the people, I don't know the culture, don't speak English, I don't know. And I need to insert in this country step by step, every day, for me, with my art. Don't have family in this country, don't have friends in this country. I need other people's for my art, for my art expression, my inside. But the art don't have language, it's universal sense, the universal feeling, no? It's my form for communication with other people.